to be together, even if we are not physically together. Last night I watched the Annapolis Valley Honor Choir online, and it was such a joyful experience to be able to be together through distance. So I'd like to give a word of welcome to those who are joining us online.
Morning.
Good morning.
A voice of one calling. In the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain, and the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Isaiah chapter 40, verses 2 to 5.
As we gather today, we claim the gift of peace that is Jesus Christ. We are mindful of the unrest that is all around us. We hear about it globally, political fear, war, injustice. We know about it locally, fear of job loss, sickness. And as we experience it personally, family conflict, difficult decisions, and worry.
Into this darkness the light has come. Into this anxiety and unrest came the gift of peace, Jesus Christ. In the face of fear, we light the candle of peace.
May the light from this candle say to all that God's peace is coming on earth as it already is in heaven. How beautiful on the mountains are the feet of those who bring good news, who proclaim peace, who bring good tidings, who proclaim salvation, who say to Zion, your God reigns. Isaiah 52, verse 7.
Friends, do not be afraid. Do not worry. God's peace has come. Let us reflect the gift of peace this Advent season.
And now we'll bow our heads to pray. Christ Jesus, born in a humble manger to working class parents, you are the light of the world, shining in the darkness of our lives. You are the Prince of Peace, bringing peace that can guard our hearts and minds. Thank you that you are Emmanuel, God with us, always and forever. Amen.
Time for love. Now let us.
scripture reading for the morning comes from the book of John, chapter 16. Verse 16 to 33, which seems a strange scripture for the time of Christmas, because it comes at the end of Jesus' life when he is giving instructions to his disciples. John chapter 16, verse 16. The words of Jesus. In a little while you will see me no more. And then after a little while, you will see me. Some of his disciples said to one another, "What does he mean? In a little while you will see me no more, then after a little while you will see me. And because I am going to the Father." They kept asking, "What does he mean, a little while? We don't understand what he is saying." Jesus saw that they wanted to ask him about this, so he said to them, "Are you asking one another what I meant when I said, 'In a little while you will see me no more, and then after a little while you will see me'? I tell you the truth, you will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve, but your grief will turn to joy. A woman giving birth to a child has pain because her time has come, but when her baby is born, she forgets the anguish because of her joy that a child is born into the world. So with you. Now is your time of grief, but I will see you again and rejoice, and no one will take away your joy. In that day, you will no longer ask me anything. I tell you the truth. My Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. Though I have been speaking figuratively, a time is coming when I will no longer use this kind of language, but will tell you plainly about my Father. In that day, you will ask in my name. I'm not saying that I will ask the Father on your behalf. No, the Father himself loves you because you loved me and have believed that I came from God. I came from the Father and entered the world, and now I am leaving the world and going back to the Father." Then Jesus' disciples said, "Now you are speaking clearly and without figures of speech. Now we can see that you know all things and that you do not even need to have anyone ask you questions. This makes us believe that you come from God." "You believe at last," Jesus answered. "But a time is coming when you will be scattered, each to his own home. You will leave me all alone. Yet I am not alone, for my Father is with me. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, for I have overcome the world." Jesus' words for us, his people. Every time I read those scripture words, there are so many there that I love and celebrate, and there's always one that I roll my eyes at. The part about Jesus saying that a mother forgets the pain, right? You know, can I get a little amen here? You know, that's the one moment in all of Christ's words that I'm like, oh. You know, coming from a man, I remember every bit of pain and rejoice for a child that's come into the world. Jesus' words for us, his people. That message of joy, that message of trouble and grief and sorrow and weeping and peace. The scripture was read from the book of Isaiah, that strong scripture of Isaiah 9 to us, a child is born. And that is a big, triumphant bit of Christmas scripture. That scripture fits with the typical and normal themes of the season. To us, a child is born. To us, a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called. And are you like me when you read this, that you pause for the little bits of the orchestra?
Yes.
Yeah, do you know what I mean? Yeah. So I say, wonderful, and in my head I go, counselor, almighty God. I won't do that. No one ever invites me to be the special guest for singing. I don't know why. Wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. These are the titles given to Jesus, and it is a triumph song of light breaking through darkness. The incredible announcement of Isaiah, and this scripture, as you know from the book of Isaiah, comes from a time in the Israelite people where they were smashed to bits when they had no hope. And Isaiah says to them, wait on the Lord. Good will come. There will be a branch from the root of Jesse. But before we get all joyful on the good news this morning, and I'm in a good mood, I love the snow. When I woke up this morning, I saw the window and I said, ho, ho, ho. There's two types of people in this world, and those who say ho, 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 and those that say, oh no. Who looked out the window this morning and said, oh no? Yeah, I feel for you. I came downstairs full of Christmas cheer, and my husband said, oh, he was out this morning putting his snow tires on. Let's just say I wasn't met with the same spirit when I came down the stairs. What it is a beautiful time, a joyful time, but those joyful titles line up with a stark reality of what is actually happening in the world, both in scripture and in our world today. They're joyful titles because they're in opposition to what's actually happening. Otherwise, they would just be normal, everyday words. It's like the Grinch lurking behind the corner of the Christmas tree. For what is the good news about a Prince of Peace if we live in a time of contentment? Who needs a wonderful counselor if we've got it all together? Do we really need a savior? Is the world really that bad off? Do we want the savior that's offered to us? Or would we simply prefer a midwinter holiday with 3 days off and lots of food? Is that all we really need? In biblical times, the prophet Isaiah was talking to a people that were divided and distracted and angry and disillusioned. They were surrounded by enemies. They had forgotten the promises of God, and they felt that God had failed them. They were a people who had continually chosen the wrong path. They disobeyed God's instructions to put him first and not their own desires. Just a few chapters earlier in the book of Isaiah are the words, hear, O heavens, listen, O earth. This is what the Lord says. The children I have raised and cared for have turned against me. Even the animals, the donkey and the ox, know their owner and appreciate their care, but not my people Israel. No matter what I do for them, they still do not understand. Oh, what a sinful nation they are. They are loaded down with a burden of guilt. They have despised the Holy One of Israel, cutting themselves off from his help. That phrase in Isaiah, that cutting themselves off, is a very interesting and very true today statement. Many psychologists and sociologists would agree that in our society, one of our greatest fears is that of abandonment, of being cut off. And yet we continually choose to abandon ourselves. We cut ourselves off from God that we were created to know. Perhaps the greatest sin of the world throughout ages is that we leave God waiting to be wanted. And yet God continually extends himself to his people. My sister worships at Windsor Baptist, and I was able to be there on a holiday Sunday, and her pastor then was Jeff White. This was a number of years ago. And I'll never forget this Advent message that he gave, because he proposed this at that time, and I'll offer that same question to you. Advent is a time of waiting, but is it we who are waiting for Christ, or is it more like Jesus who is waiting for us? In the book of Revelation, John gives a series of visions of the church and to the many different churches in the area, and one was the church at Laodicea. And there's that image of Jesus standing at the door and knocking. And I bet y'all can put in your mind the painting, right?
It's right behind me.
Oh, glory!
The window.
Oh, window. You know, I was looking for the 1940. There's an artist, a salesman. Do you know what I mean? There's the image. But he did a very famous painting as well. A couple of pictures of Jesus. It was in the 1940s. There's a paper tattered one hanging up in the churches too. So this picture, this exact picture, is from Revelation chapter 2. Knocking at the door. And classically, in that picture and this one as well, there's no doorknob on the door. So this picture based here is Christ knocking, and many people give the analogy of Christ knocking at the heart of the unbeliever. Do you know what I mean? Like, come in, let me in, unbeliever. But in the scripture, this is Christ knocking on the door of the church, which is actually a little troubling, which is actually a little disturbing to think of the Savior knocking at the door of the church saying, hello? Hello? Is anyone in there? I've been filling in as a substitute for pre-primary, and I always get locked out of the classroom. This is just a habit of mine. This goes along with my human nature, and it's not going to change. Luckily, they have a little window. And so I'll be in the little window, and I'll be knocking, and the children will look up at me and wave, you know, and I'll point down to the doorknob. And they will, you know, they'll stand there and they'll wave, and I'll keep trying to mime, you know, open the door until somebody lets me in. Christ knocking at the door of the church saying, hello, sending all of these messages saying, open, open the door. And that's an uncomfortable idea. Christ knocking at the door of this church, would we recognize the message that he's miming from outside the window for us to follow? The action, we think, oh, yeah. But are we able to do it? Throughout the entirety of the Bible, God is calling to his people, calling to us because we are a forgetful people. And we always have been. There's a Christmas, I don't know whether it's a Christmas carol class, traditionally or not, it's not often sung, except for the Muppets Family Christmas, the 80s version. It's one of my favorite Christmas songs, and the words are hit me every time. It's the one, haul, haul out the holly. It's the strangest bit, because the tune is super chipper. Put up the tree before my spirit falls again. Do you know that one?
Yeah.
If you're remembering the Muppet one, Fozzie honks the horn, you know, at that spot. Haul out the holly, put up the tree before my spirit falls again. But the thing is, the words are totally depressing. They are the saddest words. Fill up the stocking. I may be rushing things, but deck the halls again now. For we need a little Christmas. Right this very minute, candles at the window, carols at the spinet, for I've grown a little leaner, grown a little colder, grown a little sadder, grown a little older. I need a little angel sitting on my shoulder. We need a little Christmas now. Well, I would disagree with this carol only on one point. I think we need a lot of Christmas right now. I think we need a huge amount of Christmas right now. We need a king-size, super-size, whopping-size Christmas this season. This is a light all the lights kind of a year. Why? Because a people are walking in darkness. And we have seen a great light. If we look across our world, the top-selling prescriptions for us, the first one's an antipsychotic. The second one is to lower blood pressure. The third is to treat ulcers. And the fourth is an antidepressant. That's the state of the world right now. Just looking at that medication list would make us believe that this world is disturbed, is destructive, is despairing, and is depressed. That's a world that does not need a Band-Aid holiday. That's a world that does not need 3 days off and a Christmas dinner. It's a world that needs a Savior. The prophet Isaiah calls out, For us, a child is born. Wonderful Counselor, Prince of Peace, clothed in fairness and truth. These titles are meaningless without the trouble in the world that they opposed. Jesus said, in this world, you will have trouble. He said to his disciples, you will grieve, you will weep, while the rest of the world rejoices. In this world, you will have trouble. And he said, but take heart, for I have overcome the world. Like Easter, we can't celebrate the resurrection before the death. At Christmas, we need to recognize that we can't have good tidings of great joy without needing the good, recognizing the trouble, the need and the longing. So here the grand themes of Advent meet our needs. To this world that is despairing, Christ offers hope. To this world that is destructive and hurtful, Christ offers love. To fight the depression that plagues us as a people, Christ offers joy. To comfort the disturbed, whether emotionally or physically or spiritually, Christ offers peace. J.R.R. Tolkien, who is well known to many and most known for the writings The Lord of the Rings, was also a devout Christian. And he was looking at the reality of Christ, and he was a linguist. That was his heartbeat, was language. And he said, there isn't a word that describes Christ. And so he invented one. He started with the word catastrophe. He started with the word that meant trouble. The word catastrophe, the first part is Greek, and it means kata, and it means a downward spiral. And the strophe means a sudden turn. So catastrophe means a sudden downward spiral, like from it's just from good to terrible. It's a catastrophe, literally. And so Tolkien, looking at the gospel, said the gospel is the exact opposite of the word catastrophe. The gospel is a sudden, dramatic, upward turn from an awful situation to a triumphant one. And so he invented a new word called, that he wrote, eucatastrophe. That first word coming from Eucharist, the table that we are celebrating today. Christ meeting his people through the blood and his body. Tolkien wrote, the birth of Christ is the eucatastrophe of man's history. The resurrection is the eucatastrophe story of the incarnation. The story begins and ends with joy. And you can even see that in his stories, when the war is at its darkest, all of a sudden over the cliff of the hill, that burst of light comes. That light is Christ. Angel to Mary said, "Do not fear." The angel said to the shepherds, "Do not fear." And Revelation 3 reads, "Look here, I stand at the door and knock. If you hear me calling, open the door. I will come in and I will share a meal with friends. I will invite everyone who is victorious to sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious, and sit with my Father on his throne. Anyone who is willing to hear should listen to the Spirit and understand what the Spirit is saying to the churches." Are you in need of a wonderful counselor this morning? Are you in need to be led by quiet streams? Do we need a spirit of wisdom and understanding? Do we need a Prince of Peace? He invites you to this table today. Emmanuel, God with us. Friends, this is the joyful feast of the people of God. It is written that people will come from the east and the west, from the north and the south, and will sit at the table of the kingdom of God. It's written in the book of Luke, chapter 13, that when our risen Lord was at the table with his disciples, he took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them, and their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. This is the Lord's table, and I would invite those who trust in him to share this feast that has been prepared. As we prepare to celebrate the gift of the bread, I would invite you to open the top portion of your communion cup that has already been distributed, to hold the wafer ready. Hear the words of institution of the Holy Supper of our Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At this time, as we offer the bread as a symbol of Christ's broken body for us, one time for all time, we offer a prayer of blessing over the bread.
Let's pray. Lord, you came to us so long ago as just a little baby, a baby who changed our world and would change us if we opened our hearts. We celebrate this time of your birth by gathering together and remembering these amazing events. But you did even more for us by giving up that precious life to save ours. Your love and sacrifice for all of our sins is more than amazing. It's humbling and so full of your love and grace. So as we eat this bread that is your body, let's remember beyond your wondrous birth and be wholly thankful for your ultimate sacrifice for all of us. Amen.
Jesus said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take, eat, and remember." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." And he shared the cup with his disciples, and we would offer a prayer of blessing for the cup.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege to be here at your table. We thank you for the cup, the symbol of the blood that you shed for all of us. We thank you for that peace that you give each and one, every one of us, regardless of the struggles or the anxieties or any situation that comes. We have the power of your Holy Spirit that gives us that peace in the midst of those troubles. We thank you for every sacrifice that you made on our behalf, and we thank you for being our Savior and our Redeemer. And now as we take your cup, may we go and remember everything you have done and celebrate this time of year that we remember you came for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
I invite you to take back the portion to reveal the symbol of the cup. Jesus said, "Take this and divide it among you, for I tell you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. Take this cup with gratitude, thanksgiving, and love." Paul wrote that whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. We're going to share a prayer that is a hymn, "Make Me a Channel of Your Peace," number 587 in your hymnal or on the screen above. The words of 2 Peter 3, which says, "In accordance to his promise, we wait for a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness is at home. Therefore, beloved, while you are waiting for these things, strive to be found by him at peace, without spot or blemish, in regard to the patience of our Lord as our salvation. May you be blessed this day and all your days to come."